brothers and sisters from Palaghat district. For me, it is a great pleasure and honor to be here today and to be given this opportunity to share some thoughts on a very wide subject, struggles that reclaim India. There are many struggles going on all over the country. All sections of our citizens are in struggle. I would like to begin with some struggles which are going on in the field of science, because what brings us here together is the science movement. Of course, I am using the word science in a broader sense. Science as a method of understanding problems. Science in the sense of the term scientific temper. Our country, India, is unique in at least three ways. And I'm using the word unique quite precisely. What I mean is that these three things are probably not there in any other country, to the best of my knowledge. The first is that we have a constitution in which the word scientific temper is specifically mentioned. I do not know of any other constitution in the world which has the words scientific temper specifically written into the constitution. The second unique thing about our country is that we have something called a people's science movement. There are science programs, science organizations working in different parts of the world, but this concept of people's science movement, a movement of science in which all the people are involved, to the best of my knowledge, this is something unique to our country. And I think Kerala can be very proud of the fact that this concept was first articulated here in the state of Kerala by the organization that is hosting this program, which is the Kerala Shastra Sahitya Parishad. And this happened, to the best of my knowledge, sometime around in the 70s, when KSSP was building itself as a mass organization. So this whole concept of science as a mass activity and a mass organization promoting science, this is something unique as a concept to India, and the origin lies in the state of Kerala. The third thing which is unique is the universalization of good quality education. Perhaps we are the only country in the world where universalization of education of good quality is a legal requirement. And the word good quality is there in law. Not just universalization of access, but universalization of good quality education is now a fundamental right, a legal right in the Right to Education Act 2009. And what is important is that what is meant by education of good quality, that is also now defined, for which we have to look at the National Curriculum Framework 2005, NCF 2005, in which many, many important educationists from all over the country participated in formulating it. That NCF 2005 defines education of good quality as that kind of education which enables the learners to overcome the inequality into which he or she may have been born. So it defines good quality education in terms of equality, in terms of overcoming inequality. And NCF 2005 has been legally notified as a curriculum framework for the whole country under Article 7 of the Right to Education Act 2009. So this universalization of good quality education is something which, to the best of my knowledge, is unique to our country. Of course, we know that in practice, this is not happening. It is a legal right, but most of our children are not yet able to acquire this right. Most of them are still not able to get a good quality education. Maybe, but it is a legal right, and we have to move in that direction. We are all legally mandated to move in that direction. To give you an example, let us take mathematics education. What does good quality mathematics education mean? Let us think about this. Because good quality education would mean something in each and every subject. Good quality science education, good quality language education, good quality social sciences, good quality mathematics. Unless it is there in each and every subject, it is not real. What do we mean by good quality math education? Today, most children, by the time they reach class 9, class 10, they feel that mathematics is something which I want to avoid. I want to free myself as early as possible. So by the time children learn, reach class 9 and class 10, even in the so-called elite schools, in the best schools, all of them, most of them start hating mathematics, start disliking mathematics. So a system which is producing large numbers of students who are hating the subject, can we define that as good quality math education? No, but today, good quality math education is a legal right. So now, if a child is not learning mathematics, up to now it was, people would say, he does not have the ability, he is not inclined towards mathematics. We were blaming the child if a child was not learning mathematics. But after the Right to Education Act, now, we cannot blame the child. We have to hold the system responsible. If a child is not learning, then it is not the child who is responsible, it is the system which is responsible. And it is a very major change in the whole responsibility. So these three things. First is scientific temper in the Constitution. The second is universalization of good quality education. And the third is the science movement, the people's science movement. These are things which are unique to our country. And it is with this backdrop that I would like to go ahead and discuss some questions. Now, what do we mean by scientific temper? Scientific temper also is very well defined in various discussions. I will take something from a statement on scientific temper which was formulated around 1980. It says scientific temper is four things. The first is that method of science, there is something called method of science. I will not explain that to you, you are all people from science, but I think all of us know there is something called a method of science. That is the first statement, that we can use method of science to understand problems. Second statement is that we must use method of science to examine and understand reality, to seek truth. The third thing is that we must use the method of science not only in the so-called natural sciences, but in all areas of reality, including the social, political, and economic. I will repeat this. The third statement about scientific temper is that we must use the method of science to understand problems in all areas, including social, political, and economic. Let me very briefly tell you my own experience. I studied physics. After doing my doctorate, I was involved in the anti-war movement in the US, anti-Vietnam War movement as a student in the United States. And that time, I came to know about what was happening in the world. I became acquainted with what is called the leftist ideology. And I decided that the most important thing, the most important problem facing all of us is that why is it that when we have the technical and the economical abilities to resolve some basic problems like food for everybody, house for everybody, education for everybody, when the technical means for all these basic requirements is there, why is it that most people are still denied this? So I decided that this is the problem that I would like to address as a student of science. And because of the acquaintance with leftist ideology, I found that there were some very profound thinkers who addressed this problem. And I began to study those thinkers. I began to study the experience of what was happening in the world apart from India and the United States. And then I decided that I wanted to come back as soon as possible to my country and start working in this movement which will be addressing these problems, which will be organizing the people of the country in order to resolve this problem of basic needs. So when I came back, people asked me two questions. One is, why did you come back? Most of the people who go there to study sciences, they stay there and do sciences. Why have you come back? And second question was, why have you left science? So my short answer to both these questions was, firstly, that don't ask me the question as to why I came back. If an American student comes to India to study, after completing his education, he goes back to his country. Nobody there asks him, why have you come back to US? He has come back to his country. So you are directing the question to the wrong person. You should ask those people who are staying there as to why they have not returned to their country. And the second question is that, actually, who says that I've left science? Science is not a subject. Science is an approach to understanding problems. So I have left physics, perhaps, as a profession, but I still feel that I am just addressing the scientific problem, which to my mind is the most important problem that we are facing. And that is what scientific temper says. Scientific temper says that we must address all problems with the method of science. But the fact is that most scientists, including very famous and very brilliant scientists like Professor Feynman, who was my professor when I was in the US, he also gives a very nice definition of science. Feynman says in one of his articles that science is a long history of learning how not to fool yourself. What? Science is a long history of learning how not to fool yourself. But then in his other articles, he says that whenever scientists speak on non-scientific subjects, like politics and economics, they are as good as the next guy. So there he talks about non-scientific subjects, but he misses the point that science is not a subject. So by talking about scientific subjects and non-scientific subjects, by saying that physics, chemistry, biology, mathematics, these are scientific subjects, whereas economics, politics, culture, these are non-scientific subjects, this itself is escaping the conclusions or the inevitable directions that scientific temper takes us into. See, science is a very, I think all of us know that science is a very definite way of proceeding. For example, if I start walking from here, and I keep walking and I keep walking and I keep walking in the same direction, always say I walk north, and I keep walking, walking, then after some time, after a long time, after walking a lot, I will come back to where I am. All of us know that if you start walking in a direction and you keep walking in the same direction without changing direction at all, you just keep walking. If there is water, you cross the water, but you keep going in that direction for a long time, you will come back to where you are. Now that is a strange thing. I'm walking away and I come back to where I was. So science takes such evidence, such experiments, and comes to conclusions. The conclusion that the earth is round. And there is no way that you can get around this conclusion. If you start following the methods of science, you have to inevitably arrive at the conclusion that the earth is round. If I walk from here and I look at Dhruv Tara, Dhruv Tara here is making a certain angle. I walk 110 miles to the north, that angle will increase by 1 degree. I walk another 110 miles to the north, that 110 kilometers to the north, that angle will again increase by 1 degree. So there is an aspect of inevitability, unavoidability in science. And because of this inevitable, unavoidable aspect of the method of science, we reach certain conclusions. Therefore, some of these conclusions are not very convenient to us. And because you want to avoid these inconvenient conclusions, particularly in the field of politics, in the field of social relations, in the field of history, in the field of culture, it's not easy to arrive at conclusions in science. You know, it is not easy to walk a long distance and come back to where you were. It's not easy. Sometimes you have to really follow the path very steadily, very consistently. But when you do that, you arrive at certain conclusions which may not be convenient conclusions. And because people want to avoid these inconvenient conclusions, therefore they say that there are scientific subjects where you use science, and there are other subjects which are not scientific, which are have to be kept outside of science. So therefore politics, economics, and all these things, because you don't want to arrive at inconvenient conclusions. Let me give you just one more example. COVID, is that a scientific subject? All of us would say yes. Nobody will disagree that yes, COVID is a scientific subject. We want to tackle COVID crisis, we have to look at it scientifically. But then all the various other philosophies which claim to have solutions to human problems, all of them have failed. Nobody goes to them, nobody goes to a church or to a mandir or to a masjid or to any religious place to find a solution to COVID. On the contrary, people stay away from religious places, congregations, in order to avoid COVID. But is it only a technical subject, COVID? Why is it that, for example, you take two places which are located just 300 kilometers from each other? I'm taking two places in the world which are just 300 kilometers from each other. One place is called the state of Florida in the US, and the other place is called the country of Cuba. Cuba and Florida are next to each other, separated by only some 250 kilometers. But COVID, if you look at what is the COVID situation in Cuba and in Florida, the same people who left Cuba and have settled in Florida, same biological makeup. But Florida is one of the worst hit places of COVID in the world today. And Cuba is one of the best, has one of the best records as far as COVID is concerned. In Florida, at least till about a month back, every day around 200 people were dying every day because of COVID. And that has been going on for the last 6-7 months. Every day 200 people dying. In Cuba, in that same period, in this entire period of 6-7 months till today, less than 200 people have died. Now, is this not a problem which needs to be looked at scientifically, particularly in a time of COVID? Do we not need to see why is it that the state of Kerala has a much lower case fatality rate than any other part, any other state in our country? Yes, Kerala has large number of cases because so many people coming from all over the world because of this diaspora. But the case fatality rate of Kerala is about 1/5 or 1/6 of other states. What is the reason for that? The reason is not in biology, it is not in microbiology, it is not in virus structure. We cannot understand. So COVID is not just a subject of microbiology or virus structure or of chemistry or biochemistry. There is the social aspect of COVID. The systems to deal with this pandemic, and these are social, economic, and political systems. If you want to understand why Cuba is different from Florida, you cannot understand that in the natural sciences. You have to understand that in the social sciences. But people like Feynman would avoid this problem. But if you, as scientific tempered people, we have to address this problem with the methods of scientific temper. And that is why I think India has a basis for taking up some very important problems which we are going to face in the coming days. Now, let me talk about one of these aspects which we are facing today, one of the challenges to scientific temper, and that is in the form of the new education policy declared by the present central government. If you read the new education policy, you will find there is a lot of discussion. Many times the word scientific temper is used, but there are many things which are missing. What is missing is universalization. The new education policy talks about universalization of access, but universalization of good quality outcomes, which is there already in law, that is abandoned in the new education policy. And many other things in our constitution are specifically ignored, specifically excluded. For example, the word secularism, that is missing from the new education policy. Now, these are not accidental. New education policy is formulated by the same HRD department, the same education department, which says that last year, the then state HRD minister said that we should stop teaching evolution in schools. My grandfather has never seen any monkey becoming a human being. So who says that education, that evolution is a scientific theory? So we should stop teaching it in schools. Okay? The previous education minister has made this statement in public. Our prime minister talks to an audience of doctors in Mumbai, okay, 300 doctors, medical personnel, and says that we have a lot to learn from our classics because many ancient times our doctors knew how to transplant the head of an elephant into a human being. which is how Ganpati came into being. This statement is made with all seriousness. And not a single doctor there, you know, and he says this is because of the achievements of our ancients in the field of plastic surgery. This is a speech made by our Prime Minister a couple of years back. Our ministers talk about how there was very advanced technology of aircraft which our ancients had. No doctor there got up and said, "Sir, do you know the difference between plastic surgery and organ transplant?" But any child, supposing he had gone before an audience of school children, some child would have certainly gotten and asked him the question. Ganpati is an example of organ transplant, and that also very distant. But all these statements are made in official forums. They are not put to question, and scientific temper requires that we ask questions. We cannot make progress in science without asking questions, and therefore the slogan of the scientific temper movement, which was started some 3 years back, and there is a National Scientific Temper Day, which is observed every year on the 20th of August, which is the anniversary of martyrdom of Dr. Narayan Dabolkar, citizens who are fulfilling the fundamental duties as mandated in our constitution. That is what defines who is patriotic and who is unpatriotic. So I told him that if you are saying, sir, that asking why is not correct, then please read your constitution, because it is you who are being unpatriotic. And that is the attitude with which we have to proceed now, because as you know, there is a very major struggle going on in all areas. There is a major contest going on in all areas. There is an attempt to curtail the questioning, the explorations, the democratic space in the universities, in the streets. There are all these laws which are being passed to curtail the democratic rights that all of us have as Indian citizens. There are the journalists, even in the field of mass media, there is attempts being made to curtail the discussion of important questions, the giving coverage to important struggles which are taking place all over the country. Now, those journalists who are asking questions and who are doing journalism, which is to bring up the real facts, all of them have lost their jobs. People like Abhisar Sharma, people like Ravish Kumar, all of them have had to move. Very few of them have their jobs, but they're asking those questions. Asking questions in the field of journalism, in the field of politics. So these are the people who are in the front line of scientific temper. They are the ones who are the really patriotic Indians and all of us as patriotic Indians, we should, without hesitation, very publicly, we should ask the important questions. We should arrange discussions of all the important questions which are taking shape in our country in various areas today. And yes, let there be an open discussion. It's not that we have to put forward just one point of view. Let there be a discussion. Let there be different points of view coming forth in science. That debate is very important. Let that debate take place. But avoiding debate is unscientific. We should hold debates on the questions, let people from different sides speak, and let the citizens make up their mind. And therefore, asking why is a very important part of the democratic struggles which are taking place in our country today. And by promoting scientific temper, by promoting a culture of asking questions and feeling free to ask questions. And when anybody tries to stop you, we tell them, look, read your constitution. You need to understand what it means to be an Indian. As Indians, we have certain, not only rights, but we have certain duties. And it is one of those duties, not only a right, one of those duties is to ask the important questions. And that is what we are trying to do. So with this approach, we have to actually enter into those areas which today are denied to us. There is an attack in the field of education on scientific thinking. As I mentioned to you, there are attempts being made to change the syllabus in states like Gujarat, in states like Madhya Pradesh, to introduce many subjects in the curriculum which will not face scientific questioning. The moment you ask scientific questions, they will cannot survive that kind of questioning. But because of political power, they're being introduced into the curriculum. So through science education, through the science curriculum, we have to encourage the students, no matter where they are, whether in Gujarat, whether in Madhya Pradesh, whether in Kerala, whether in Maharashtra, or in Kashmir, or in the Northeast, we have to encourage students to be unafraid to ask questions. And that is something that we can do as people from the science movement, from organizations like Shastra Sahitya Parishad or other organizations in the science movement. And clearly, one of the most important questions that the country is facing today is that of the farmers' issues, those three farmers' laws. Is that a scientific question? Some people will say, no, that is politics. Don't enter into that area. But if we believe in scientific temper, we have to reply that there is no area which is scientific or unscientific. We have to take up that question of these farmers' laws, and we have to look at the evidence. We have to ask the questions. We have to look at how these laws came into being. We have to discuss them. And if we do that, we can arrive at conclusions which are difficult to refute. Just for example now, how justified is it for the farmers to demand that the laws should be unilaterally withdrawn? Very valid question. This is an elected government which has come to power. They have enacted the laws. Is that not the democratic process? What right do the farmers have to oppose these laws which have been enacted by a democratically elected government? This is the kind of questions that are being asked in some sections of the social media. Now, we have to answer that question. The question is, okay, the government has enacted these laws, but why was the need to first bring in these three laws as an ordinance? What was the urgency? And after these three laws were tabled, why was it not sent like so many other laws which have been passed? Why was it not sent before a standing committee to hear the, get the inputs of the different stakeholders? In that part, the government is avoiding the democratic process. And if the government is avoiding the democratic process, then certainly protesting peacefully is a democratic right of Indian citizens. So we have every democratic right, and the farmers are entirely democratically empowered, entitled to express their opposition through constitutional democratic methods to these laws. Passing the laws was done by a democratically elected government, but the process by which those laws were enacted was not democratic. There was a violation of democracy there. And therefore, protesting against these laws is well within the rights, the democratic rights of the stakeholders, the people affected by this. What will be the implications of these laws? I will not get into all those details because that is not the subject of my talk today. I'm talking about method, talking about approach, I'm talking about the relationship of scientific method to such questions. The farmers have said that they will not withdraw until these laws are withdrawn. After discussing all these questions, if we arrive at the conclusion that yes, the demand of the farmers is justified, then the question that we have to ask ourselves is that, can we sit here just watching the situation there? Can we sit here and say that that is a problem for the farmers of Haryana and Punjab and the north who produce rice and wheat, which is procured, but there is no procurement of rice and wheat taking place in Kerala, so it is really not a problem for Kerala? Can we take such an approach? As Indians, as scientific persons, we have to understand that the implications of these laws are going to hit states like Kerala also very hard, because Kerala is a state which depends critically on the public distribution system. In fact, Kerala has one of the best public distribution systems in the country. Now, these three laws are formulated in a way to demolish, to dismantle the public distribution system, to replace the state public distribution system by the market mechanism. Again, I will not get into these details, but we have to understand that one of the objectives of these three laws is to remove the Food Corporation of India as the corporation which is empowered and which is allowed to stock food grains, to close down the Food Corporation of India and to transfer that entire function to the private corporate sector, particularly the Adani Group. So the Adani Group is being given the monopoly rights in stocking and hoarding of food grains. And therefore, when that happens, the price of food grains, all those things which we get at fair prices today, that is going to change. It is going to affect the public distribution system of Kerala very much. But moreover, it is also something, why is the government under so much pressure to go through with these laws when there is so much opposition? We have to understand that this is part of a much bigger economic crisis that our country is facing. GDP has fallen over the last year, but actually this was happening even before COVID. Their debt is measured in lakhs of crores. That money is invested in power plants which cannot sell electricity. So if they are not helped in some way with some subsidy, they are going to collapse like Malia collapsed. And it is for this reason that this government is so urgently eager to give food grain hoarding and food grain distribution into the hands of the Adanis, because it is there that they hope to make the kind of profits by which they can repay the loans which are being hidden right now because of COVID. Because of COVID, Reserve Bank says you don't need to declare NPAs for some time. If Reserve Bank had not said that, there would be many NPAs and Gautam Adani loans would figure in that list of NPAs. So this whole urgency is to give the Adanis of this country a way to earn huge amounts of money. And I'm not saying this again just as empty words. I'm saying this based on certain evidence. If you look at what happened to the price of dal in the year 2016, you will recall that the price of dal went up to 180 rupees, 200 rupees per kilo. At that time, where was that money going? At that time, dal was available in the international market at 35, 40 rupees per kilo. Why was our government not importing dal at 35, 40 rupees? There is the corporations which can import food grains and distribute food grains. That was the job being done by the Food Corporation of India earlier. Why was our government, why was that government of 2016 not doing that to put a limit on the price of dal? Where did all the money, we were paying 200 rupees per kilo, where was that money going? That money went into the hands of a company called Adani Wilmar. Adani Wilmar company in that period made, some people say, more than 1 lakh crore of rupees of profits. I don't have all the details, so I will not give the exact figure. But certainly it was of that order of magnitude. Adani Wilmar made astronomical profits in that one Dal episode of 2016. So there, they have understood what can happen. And now in the last 2 years prior to the enaction of these acts, Adani has built huge godowns, each of which can contain 5 lakh, 6 lakh tons of food grains in all the major states. So this is the issue which is there in the farmers' agitation. And therefore, even states like Kerala, which may not be very much affected by procurement, but you are certainly which have a stake in the public distribution system, this is something that is a issue for the entire country. I will not talk about the other aspects. I just want to say that all these issues are issues where we have to look at the evidence, and we have to, when we look at the evidence with the method of science, we arrive at conclusions which are inescapable. And it is this discussion, these debates, which we have to take to the broader population. I'm not saying that KSSP should now start organizing political meetings. I'm not saying that, no. Not at all. But what I am saying is that all the science organizations have to organize meetings to promote asking of questions, to highlight the fact that asking of questions is not anti-national. In fact, it is patriotic to ask questions, have to promote good science education, encourage children to ask questions, and also mention this fact that asking questions cannot be restricted to just the natural sciences. We are human beings. All aspects of our existence require us, require to be looked at scientifically. An issue like COVID is not just an issue of natural sciences. It is an issue of broader dimensions, and we have to look at those dimensions to understand how to fight COVID. And when we do look at these issues, we will find, because science always finds solutions. And where do those solutions lie? I will conclude by saying, friends, two things. One is how we can support the farmers who are fighting in Delhi. What is it that we can do? Very briefly, let me tell you about what we are initiating in Maharashtra. See, the Prime Minister and his advisors are not listening to the farmers or to the workers. They have raised the questions, they have shown with such courage, 150 people have died in that dharna, in cold, in the rain. But this government cannot listen, does not have the eyes and ears to see and hear what the farmers are saying, or to see and hear what the workers are saying. So what we decided in the trade unions, I'm from a trade union movement in Maharashtra. There is something called the Trade Union Joint Action Committee. We discussed this, and the Trade Union Joint Action Committee in Maharashtra has taken the decision that to those entities to whom the Prime Minister is listening, those corporations to whom this Prime Minister is discussing with, is listening, who have the ears and the eyes of the Prime Minister, we will put the pressure on those corporations, and we will do it in such a way, and it's not very difficult. We will put pressure on the Ambanis and on the Adanis in our own way, and we will put that pressure in such a way that the same Mukesh Ambani and Gautam Adani will run to the Prime Minister and say, please do something quickly, take back those laws. Because there is something which is more important than those laws. For Mukesh Ambani, what is important is Jio. Not just the Jio telecom service, but all the ancillary activities, Jio Pay, Jio Retail. Not only Ambani, but even Google and Facebook have invested hugely in Jio. This whole country's economy, the whole talk about Digital India, even the new education policy is largely built in order to promote Jio. Money at that time made the slogan, I remember some many years back, Kar lo dunya hamari mutthi mein. That was the slogan. Hindi means, take the world in your hands. Kar lo dunya apni mutthi mein. We have to tell Ambani, Mukesh bhai, aapki Jio hamari mutthi mein hai. And the trade union movement has, in Maharashtra, has taken the decision that we are going to systematically get our members to port out of Jio and go to any other service provider. So we are encouraging BSNL, but that is not a hard and fast condition. We say prefer BSNL, but if BSNL service in your area is not good, go to somebody else, but go out of Jio. And we have taken gate meetings of our factories, workers have agreed, and now in February we are going to organize this on a mass scale. Boycott Jio, get out of Jio, don't buy petrol at Reliance retail, at Reliance petrol pumps. And similarly, Adani is also there in retail. His Fortune oil. So ban Adani, port out of Adani's electrical services in the cities. When this happens, this is a way in which the entire country, everywhere in the country, we can put solid pressure on this government to listen to the farmers. Of course, they will certainly listen to Ambani and Adani. The second thing which I would like to suggest, and I will conclude with that, is that we are now in the 73rd year of our independence. In 2 years, we will be observing the 75th anniversary of independence. Many of us, and most of us in the country, do not know about our constitution, about the Indian constitution, about some of the things that I have been talking about, the fundamental rights, the directive principles of our constitution. Most of us are not aware about this. So let us collectively decide to take the values of the constitution very vigorously to the rank and file, to the students, to the teachers, to the citizens. And it is a constitution in which scientific temper is there. Organizations like KSSP can certainly take this on the agenda of taking the constitution and giving an understanding of the constitution to all our rank and file members. And while doing that, also talking about democratic rights, talking about secularism, all the other equality, all those values which we hold. And when we do this, we will be strengthening the foundations. We will be strengthening the struggles that are going on to reclaim India. There has been some gains by the adversaries in the last few years, but those gains are gains which can be easily reclaimed. Not easily, but which can be readily reclaimed if all of us work systematically in the areas where we are working. And let us work scientifically, because we as a people working in the science movement, we have this instrument, we have this vehicle to reach out, and we know that it is a very powerful, a very strong vehicle. Let us not fail to use the strength of this vehicle in order to strengthen the constitution, in order to reclaim our nation. Thank you. I'll stop here.